I sell you about why SimilarWeb and market intelligence are so key for content marketers and understanding what's happening in the world and how you should be reaching your audiences in the most effective way. Because we didn't have so much time, instead we're going to have a very different type of conversation. And now, because I don't have a presentation, it's going to be even more intimate and personal. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you a little bit about our content marketing strategy, and more importantly, instead of just about the pieces of content that we use, the way we approach actually distributing them, I'm going to tell you about how we built our team. And hopefully, the idea of this conversation, it would imagine in big, beautiful letters on a PowerPoint, would be said calling this aligning brand and content. And so what we're going to discuss a little bit is how a content team comes together and how we should be considering that content team so that we're aligning it with the types of things we want to produce. So for those of you who don't know SimilarWeb so well, we are a market intelligence platform, and we have a very simple goal. That goal is to change the way that businesses around the world make decisions. So that goal is not, in fact, all that simple. It's very wide, it's very large. We deal with multiple organizations across a company. So we talk to marketing, we speak with sales, we speak with corporate, we talk to their M&A departments, investors. And that creates a challenge number one. Now, challenge number two is we don't have any one clear industry. We could be reaching industries across the world. So we work in travel, we work in marketing tech and advertising technology, publishers and the like. So we're reaching a wide swath of potential industries as well. So we have this really unique challenge in that we're trying to talk to a lot of different personas, and we're trying to do that across basically every industry. And so instead of being able to really target the way we would like, we now need to think in a little bit of a broader term. And when we do that most effectively when we think in terms of the brand, of who we are, and what we're trying to do. So the first thing that we do very often is we look at the companies that we think are doing really well. And so again, I want you to imagine a nice slide. It's got, oh, there we go. See? You guys are moving along. Oh, I apologize. My Hebrew name is Eitan. Does that count? Bear with me just a moment. It's got my name in there and everything. Isn't this exciting? All right. So again, SimilarWeb, and I want to tell you a little story. Story about a company called Blue Apron. This is just to take two steps back. I do want to give you a sense of what we do, just to put it in more context of why it's interesting and exciting. A company called Blue Apron, they went public earlier this summer. There was a lot of fanfare, news outlets were going crazy, people love food delivery kits, and here's this first big company that's going to go public. Now, what was really interesting about Blue Apron is that they were crushing the competition in terms of their digital performance. Their web traffic was almost double the nearest competitor. They were seeing tons of visits to their site. It was expanding all the time, and people were getting really excited about the potential. Now, what was interesting is we started looking into it a little bit further, and what we saw was there was something that popped that didn't sit so well with us. And the thing that popped that didn't sit so well with us was that as they were growing over time, their engagement was staying stagnant. And we looked a little bit further, and we saw that a lot of the new traffic that they were getting was paid. And if you're using paid as a mechanism to grow, and you're getting a lot more traffic, but you're not seeing engagement rise, then we might be seeing low-quality traffic. And if you're dealing with a site that wants people to be engaging at least 4 times a month, so that there's your benchmark, because you've got to go in once a week to order your food for the coming week, then you're going to see a bit of a challenge. So what we saw, and we sent out a really nice piece of content to our customers in the investor space, was that things didn't look so good for Blue Apron, and from a digital performance perspective, and it's something to keep in mind. Now, for those of you that follow, Bloomberg called their eventual IPO the bust of the decade. So not a positive experience for the folks at Blue Apron, but a very interesting experience for us, because we saw a bunch of different things. One, we saw that investors could be gaining a lot from market intelligence. Two, we saw that marketers could be looking at these strategies and understanding what would work and really support long-term goals over time. Now, catching up to where we were, the way we look at the world is, this is data. When you A/B test and you compare your performance and you look at your Google Analytics every day and you dig in to see which email marketing campaign performed better than the other one and whether the handsome guy looking at the call to action performs better than just the handsome guy looking away, to steal the example from the previous speaker, it's fantastic. And if I walked in and you walk into a board meeting and you say, guys, we have a 30% click-through rate, our growth is 40% month over month, and we should all high-five and be super excited. Now, what we believe is that data doesn't have real meaning and value because it exists in a silo. And we believe that you need to take a step back and understand what everyone else is doing well. Now, I could walk up here and tell you that I am the handsomest member of the Chernofsky family, and that might be true, but if there's only one man in the Chernofsky family, it doesn't mean all that much. So if you have 30% growth month over month, you can always celebrate and thinking that's fantastic, but if everyone in your industry is growing by 100% month over month, it's not all that great. Now, if you're only growing 5%, but everyone else is decreasing by 10%, all of a sudden it's pretty darn amazing, right? So we really believe that for data to have meaning, it requires context. The way we provide that context is by giving you access to the digital performance of every website, every mobile app, all over the world. And we do it for companies like all of these and many, many more. And now let's go back to where we were before, which is how do we create a brand-aligned content strategy? So again, we're reaching tons of different industries, tons of different personas, and now we need to ask, how do we do this in an effective, scalable way? So the first thing we did is we looked at companies that we really liked. One of them is a company called NerdWallet. NerdWallet really understood what is the strategy and ideas behind the way that they go through content marketing. They looked at a space they operate alongside a massive competitor called Credit Karma. Credit Karma has incredible brand recognition, Companies come to them all the time. Users come to them all the time. They are dominating the world, but they have one gap. They were not investing a ton in SEO. So NerdWallet said, how can we use organic search to catch up? And what they did was they built a team of many, many content writers. They had a very strong SEO department, and they were able to grow a significant share by putting together lots of content on highly searched terms. So what are the best credit cards to use? What's the best bank? What's the best app for investing? Things that people were looking for, and they were able to channel an SEO process to drive their content thinking and then to gain market share. Another company that is not on this slide is a company called Mint. Mint existed for 2 years before selling to Intuit for $190 million. Their vice president of marketing was a friend who I had the opportunity to work with for a short time. And he has a really interesting strategy on content. First thing he realized is that people didn't have personal finance data, and he could use that personal finance data in an anonymized way and share it with media to generate initial attention. And then he realized that they had a blog that had a really unique voice. Most of the things in finance at the time were either speaking to you like a parent, speaking to you like a company, but no one was really talking to young people. So he said, we want to have the voice of your friend that has it together. Not the richest person in the world, just the guy who's you know, he knows to wear a suit to work, he dresses nicely, he's doing well, and he's someone you can trust. So they put together this blog, and then apart from just making it a component of their strategy, they made it a centralized piece of the way they interacted. And so what happened is when people would go to their site, very often the first thing they would see was the blog. Not the homepage, not a specialized landing page, not something to drive their next event, but the blog. And they saw that their conversions were skyrocketing. Because if they could engage with that first point of contact with who they were going to have a much more effective manner of getting you through the funnel. So when we went through this process, we asked ourselves, what are our content goals? Are we trying to reach just our customers for an education process? Are we trying to push leads down the funnel? Are we trying to speak to our free users? Because we have a freemium product, so we have many, many users, millions of users who are coming on a monthly basis to use our free products. So we have this vast audience that we need to reach. And we gotta ask ourselves, what is the goal of our content? And once we understand the goal, then we can try and figure out what is the strategy. So what we realized is that our goal from a content perspective was education. We had a big platform, we had a lot of people who were trying to use it, and we just wanted to make it so that anyone who touches a similar web product would have a better experience, would be able to go a level deeper than they were able to go the day before. And by doing that, we realized that we would be able to develop a relationship with both free users who were using our free product, paying users who were using kind of our pro service and our more advanced kind of offerings, but that our primary goal was education. And then we asked ourselves, you know, who are we? So if our goal is education, who are we as a company? And the first thing we said is, we're data-driven. We genuinely care about data. We don't just do it because it's fun. We don't just sell a product. We actually use our own product in-house. It's a methodology, it's a belief system. And if that's the case, that we're really data-driven, and we really believe what we say, then we thought we had to look at content very differently. And so, at SimilarWeb, we realized that we had to embrace insight. And for us, that meant thinking about how we built our team. So whereas, you know, I spent 5 years at a PR agency here in Tel Aviv, and we worked with dozens of companies across the sector here and had a chance to see a lot of content teams. And content teams are generally made up of really creative, really talented writers and people who are doing video and you know, sometimes it's technical writers, but it's that creative type, it's the softer skills. We said, no, it's not who we are. So we have a content team that's made up 75% of analysts. Data analysts, if you ask them to write a blog tomorrow, it is going to be horrendous. I know this because I have to edit them 10 times. But we said, if we really believe in data, and data is really who we are, and the analysis and insights and the education is really what matters, then let's push that to the forefront. And it's been fundamental to our growth and success and to the development of our identity as a company. Because the second you say the most important thing is not how catchy the writing is, though it's important, and your subject line should be great, and your call to action should be clear. But that step before is also equally important. It's who are you as a company? And very often when we're smaller, we're so focused on growth, and we're so focused on gaining users in the fastest possible way, that we forget to ask those basic questions. Who are we? Where do we fit? What are we trying to accomplish? And you see it all the time. You know, a new company will come up in the travel space, and they'll try to copy TripAdvisor and produce reviews. But it's done. It's not a unique differentiated identity. And so I think hopefully the benefit of me not coming up here and just trying to sell kind of a product to you and being a little bit more open about, you know, how we came to this. I think it's a chance to step back from whatever we're doing and ask, why are we doing it the way we're doing it? And at the core fundamentals of how we build our teams and how we approach a content marketing process, is it aligned with who we really are? So if you care about, you know, VR at time, are the people on your company using it? I'm stealing the example just because they were there. If I work at LinkedIn and I want to, you know, again, just pulling from the companies that I got to see speak just before me, are there recruiters on my team? Are there people who are prospecting through the product that are defining our marketing strategy? Because if we really want to engage with our target audiences, if we really want to speak on the sake of our company and on the sake of our identity, we need to live that identity. And we need to truly put ourselves in the shoes of our audience. So, thank you very much for having me, and I hope this is helpful. Thanks so much.